is number 27 in the history of early jazz. This show featuring Louis Armstrong, jazzman extraordinaire, born July 4th in New Orleans, 1900. Died July 6th, 1971. The most remarkable man in the history of jazz, and certainly the outstanding figure in the history of early jazz, was Louis Armstrong. We heard him, by the way, last show as a part of King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band. I'd like to focus on Louis in this next hour in all different kinds of combinations, so you can see the development and growth that he did. We heard a version of one of the most famous compositions in jazz, and it was an Oliver Armstrong original, Dippermouth Blues, that he recorded for Jeanette Records. And I promised that we would hear the second version, and we're going to do it right now, as they recorded for OK Records, June 23rd, 1923. Let's hear then King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band, comprising Joe Oliver and Louis on cornets, Honoré Dutré trombone, Johnny Dodds clarinet, Lil Hardin piano, Johnny St. Cyr banjo, and the vocal you'll hear on Dippermouth Blues from the banjoist, and Warren Baby Dodds on drums, as they do the very famous Dippermouth Blues. Let's listen particularly for Louis' solo after the break, the vocal break, and of course we're paying particular attention to Johnny Dodds' unique and now hackneyed clarinet solo right after the opening chorus of Dippermouth Blues. A very nice write-out by Louis Armstrong on Dippermouth Blues, half of his composition. Ikey Smith was a fine banjo player in Chicago, and he contributed to the jazz repertoire a tune called Mabel's Dream. Our interest in it is that King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band recorded it, and we find that it is the most superb piece of cornet duet work in jazz recording. Let's listen to the famous Joe Oliver, Louis Armstrong team with the rest of the band playing Mabel's Dream. in Chicago in 1923 with King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band. Coming in 1924, as he did to New York, on the urging and behest of Fletcher Henderson, was a particularly miserable time in his professional career, but it taught him one thing, that he had better learn to read music if he wanted to get ahead. He didn't have to read music because he had this superb sense of musicality about him so that he could ad-lib anything. And he had to ad-lib very quickly in King Oliver's Band, especially for those duets, which were not rehearsed in the ordinary sense of playing a written arrangement, because at that point he couldn't read music. And so in a similar setup, when he got to New York, the Richard M. Jones counterpart of OK was Clarence Williams, the famous pianist, composer, and publisher. And so we have Clarence Williams' Blue Five with the great New Orleans Creole Sidney Bechet on clarinet and soprano sax, and Louis on cornet, coming in with the kind of small band jazz that he was used to, playing in December of 1924, Mandy, Make Up Your Mind. Like that sarousaphone that Sidney Bechet played in addition to his soprano sax. What a great sound. Clarence Williams' Blue Five, Louis Armstrong on cornet, Charlie Irvis trombone, Sidney Bechet playing both soprano sax and sarousaphone. That what it really is a bass saxophone. Clarence Williams, piano, Buddy Christian, banjo, and Eva Taylor, Mrs. Clarence Williams, the charming vocalist, December 17th, 1924, in New York, while Louis was here as part of the Fletcher Henderson Orchestra. And now joining the Fletcher Henderson Orchestra in the recording studio on February 2nd, 1925, as only one of three cornets, the other two being Elmer Chambers and Howard Scott, very, very fine musicians, with Charlie Green trombone, Buster Bailey clarinet, Don Redman clarinet, tenor, alto, and oboe, Coleman Hawkins clarinet, tenor sax, and that wretched C melody sax, Fletcher Henderson on piano, Charlie Dixon banjo, Ralph Escudero tuba, Kaiser Marshall drums. What an all-star lineup, the greatest black musicians in New York City, playing with Fletcher Henderson. He is the arranger of this great band doing Poplar Street blues. You can hear Louis doing his jazz cornet work, even though this was a very heavily arranged session. Great jazz from Fletcher Henderson's orchestra. I mentioned the personnel, but perhaps you weren't quite aware of the importance of this personnel, with Buster Bailey on clarinet, who was later to be the clarinetist for Duke Ellington's orchestra. And, of course, Don Redman, who turned out to be not only a great orchestra leader himself, but one of the great jazz arrangers of all time. and not forgetting Coleman Hawkins, the greatest tenor sax player of all, starting out recording for Fletcher Henderson's group, this all-star group that Louis Armstrong, a fish out of water, really, because he couldn't lead and all the other guys could. And so they went along with Fletcher's great arranging, his unusual voicings. And even though Louis contributed greatly, he was still not feeling very happy. Let's listen to another one of these fine recordings from February of 1925 with Fletcher Henderson and his orchestra, with Louis Armstrong sort of sitting in and contributing some very solid stuff. 12th Street Blues. Refreshing takeoff on 12th Street Rag, this one called by Billy Hegney, 12th Street Blues. For the final session on Pathé that... For the final session on Pathé that Fletcher Henderson's dance orchestra, if you will, did with some of the greatest jazz men of all time in New York, did a pop tune called Me Niña, or My Little One, Louis Armstrong very much in evidence with Fletcher Henderson's orchestra. Thank you. And that was Louis Armstrong with Fletcher Henderson's fine orchestra in February of 1925 in New York. For Louis' last recordings in New York, take us to November 1925, when he met up with Perry Bradford, as everybody must, a unique publisher, songwriter, entrepreneur, and general braggart. Perry Bradford was unique, also a singer. We'll hear Perry talking and singing with Louis' great cornet, Perry Bradford's Jazz Fools, that's spelt P-H-O-O-L-S, doing Lucy Long.
All wicked costume makes all the gals seem too wild. Strolling down Lux Avenue, they all call her that pretty Lucy Long. There she goes.
Bradford's Jazz Fools with Louis Armstrong on his last recording date in New York City. Back quickly to Chicago once again, where Louis was happiest, surrounded by his old friends, King Oliver and his Creole Jazz Band. But he made newer friends, and so moonlighting, not really moonlighting, but while he was playing at Lincoln Gardens at night, he played with Erskine Tate's Vendome Orchestra during the afternoon, when they played the Vendome Movie House. And so this orchestra only recorded two sides, and we'll hear both of them. In Chicago, May 1926, we'll hear Static Strut, and we'll feature Louis on cornet and the legendary Teddy Weatherford on the piano.
Thank you.
for the second great side of two. Erskine Tate's Vendome Orchestra will hear something that is outrageously great. Teddy Weatherford, the pianist, was a legend in his own time, simply because he didn't make very many recordings or appear with very many bands before he went to Calcutta, India. Now, a lot of black musicians in the 20s went to Europe, and they stayed there because they were revered, and everybody loved their music, and they could make a damn good living, had a lot of respect, and enjoyed themselves living in Europe. Much more respect and much more enthusiasm for their kind of music than here in this country. But Calcutta, India? Which is why we don't know too much of Teddy Weatherford, although Earl Hines was said to have been tremendously influenced by him. Let's listen now. We'll have a nice piano break by Teddy, and we'll have a tremendous Louis Armstrong chorus on Stomp Off, Let's Go. What did you say?
Stomp off, let's go!
One of the hottest records of all time. Stomp Off, Let's Go, and they sure did. Louis Armstrong with Erskine Tate's Vendome Orchestra, a happy six-piece group, one of the happiest, in fact. In April 1927, still in Chicago, where he was to remain for the next few years, Louis joined a very peculiar group, peculiar to Chicago, and that's the little skiffle group sound that Jimmy Bertrand and Jimmy Blythe so loved to indulge in. Bertrand, of course, washboard, Jimmy Blythe, of course, the greatest of the Chicago blues pianists. And into this situation fell our friend Johnny Dodds on clarinet, and joined with his friend for this particular session, Louis Armstrong. What a great quartet. What an unlikely quartet. Doing the pop tune, If You Wanna Be My Sugar Papa. Lovely, intimate group, quartet. Louis Armstrong, Johnny Dodds, Jimmy Blythe, and Jimmy Bertrand. If You Wanna Be My Sugar Papa. What a different Louis Armstrong we're hearing. And that's nothing compared to the different Louis Armstrong we're about to hear, because in February of 1926, the OK Record Company wanted Louis to make records on his own, starring Louis Armstrong, if you will, not just merely the second cornet of King Oliver. And so taking most of King Oliver's men with him, and of course woman, starting in February of 2nd, 1926, we find in Chicago Louis Armstrong's Hot Five, consisting of Louis on cornet, Kid Ory, the famous Creole trombonist whom we heard earlier, who had made the first records, Black Jazz Band records from California in 1922. We heard him then with Jelly Roll Morton's Red Hot Peppers. And here we find him still in Chicago with Louis Armstrong's Hot Five. Johnny Dodds, as ever, on clarinet. Lil Hardin Armstrong, now Armstrong, notice, his wife on piano. Johnny St. Cyr, banjo, doing his own composition, Cornet Chop Suey. Thank you. chop suey. There's no doubt who is the boss here. In fact, the only other soloist was his wife, which I guess is the privilege of being the wife of Louis Armstrong. And a not too bad piano solo either. Little Hardin Armstrong acquitted herself rather nicely. But there is no doubt who is the boss. And so on our next presentation, our old friend Jelly Roll Morton becomes the composer of a great tune called Chicago Breakdown. We heard King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band last time do it, and now we're going to hear Louis and his Hot Seven. Seven, yes, we find on cornets Louis and Bill Wilson. Honoré Dutré back on trombone. Boyd Atkins, Joe Walker, and Albert Washington reeds. Earl Hines on piano. Rip Bassett, banjo and guitar, and Pete Briggs, tuba, Tubby Hall drums. Doing in May 9th, 1927, the fine Jelly Roll Morton composition, Chicago Breakdown. That was Chicago Breakdown by Louis Armstrong and his Hot Seven, and it really was. Wasn't that a neat solo that he took? And how about that fancy footwork from Earl Hines? It was so good, in fact, that I would like us to hear from a June 1928 session, a whole year later, with the Hot Five doing Earl Hines' famous composition, A Monday Date. We'll hear a little vocal between the two, Louie and Earl, and then let her rip.
There, Earl Hines. Why don't you let us in on some of that good music, Pop?
Well, come on here. Let's get together then.
All right. Tune up, boys. Is that all right?
That sounds pretty good.
Yes, that sounds pretty good. I bet if you had a half a pint of Miss Circe's gin, you wouldn't say that sounds pretty good. Well, anyhow, we're going to play anyway. Say, come on, Zooty, whip them cymbals, Pops. You promised me last Tuesday. I have found a cozy place. So please phone me at noonday. But remember September, when the preacher says we build a coup forever and ever. Have to make a Monday day for any state we'll.
That was a Monday date with Louis Armstrong and Earl Hines just having a ball, and so I hope did you. The next tune is a very unusual and interesting one, recorded in Chicago for OK on July 5th, 1928, but never released by them. Instead, we find the only original copy on Argentine Odeon. Why? The first time it was ever released was... in America was on an LP in the early 70s. It's called Savoyager's Stomp, and it was Carol Dickerson's Savoyager's. He was the director and the violinist. In this particular band is, of course, Louis Armstrong and Homer Hobson, trumpets. And now Louis's on trumpet, no longer on cornet. Fred Robinson's the trombonist, Ben Curry and Crawford Washington alto saxophones, Jimmy Strong clarinet and tenor sax, Earl Hines very much on piano, Mancy Cara banjo, Pete Briggs tuba, and Zooty Singleton drums. We can really hear Louie because he's featured throughout, starting with this very famous beginning. Savoyager's Stomp by Carol Dickerson and the Savoyagers featuring Louis Armstrong. Thank you.
what, 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 oh. What, what, love. What, I believe. What, 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 what,
obviously isn't the Voyager Stomp, but probably the greatest of all Louis Armstrong recordings, West End Blues, with Earl Hines, with his Hot Five. And I'd like you just to listen to the vocal and the great, great cornet artistry of Louis Armstrong.